Hi guys, in this video I'm going to be showing you a few experiments to do with the Voyager spacecraft. Basically, it's a very interesting question to ask. How is it that they're able to use the gravitational pull of a planet to accelerate a spacecraft? Which at first you think, well, a spacecraft is drawn towards the planet, of course it'll go faster. But if you look at the detail, you'll realize that the spacecraft, as it falls towards the planet, for that kinetic energy that it gains to be useful, it needs to travel out the other side and continue on away from the planet, in which case the planet will take back what it gave in terms of velocity. So how do you end up with a net gain of kinetic energy after encountering a planet? And this was a challenge faced by the Voyager team way back in the 70s when they launched the spacecraft. So I'm going to devise 5 experiments. The first one here is to do with 2 Jupiters, and basically I'm just going to show that I'm going to test the software, really, is what I'm doing. I want to make sure that the software reflects nature in how it calculates physics. So we've got these 2 Jupiters here, and I'm going to hit the timer and make it start counting forward soon. But first I need to make sure that they're both not moving. They're both bodies are at rest, and so the only force acting on them is their own gravity. And then I'm going to stop the clock just before they actually collide, and I'm going to check out, relative to each other, how fast each one is moving. So let's just stop the clock. There we go. Now let's jump in and have a look at their relative velocities. Now that's 25 kilometers per second. Okay, cool. Now what about the next one? Also 25 kilometers per second. So that makes sense. That's perfectly okay, and that's what you would expect out there in the real universe. So that's really good. Now, the 2 Jupiters have the same mass, and it's because they have the same mass that they have the same velocity when the same force is applied, or the same acceleration, because that end velocity is actually a product of accelerating over the same period of time. Now, this next experiment, experiment number 2, this is the same exact situation, only this time we're going to change one variable. We're going to change the mass of the second planet, and you can see I've selected Pluto here. And so Pluto, with a much smaller mass, we're going to see if there's any difference. Will Pluto and Jupiter be moving the same speed by the time they're about to collide, or will they have a different velocity? And I can give you a bit of a clue here. So, and I mean, this is pretty straightforward, Newtonian mechanics. So for those of you who already know this stuff, you can skip ahead of the video, but for those who don't know, this is kind of important. It details effectively what's going to be happening when we try and do a Voyager simulation later on. So it's important to understand this stuff, I guess, just out of interest. Now, F equals MA, so force equals mass times acceleration. We can say that the force is definitely the same on both bodies. The mass is different, therefore, what will the acceleration be? Well, we can see by that long trail behind Pluto, it seems like that at a glance, the acceleration of Pluto is much greater, which, if you do the math, you'll see is a requirement, actually. It's necessary that that is so that the force will always be the same. If the masses are different, then you must have different accelerations, because you've got to multiply the mass and the acceleration together. So to get the same answer, if you change one number, you've got to change the other. I'm just slowing down time here so they don't actually collide, getting very, very close to the surface of Jupiter. I really do like the shadow effect there. It's really cool. It reminds you are in a 3D world here. 56 kilometers per second for Pluto. Okay, so that's really quick. That's really quick. That's certainly indicates what we said before. Let's check out Jupiter. And 0.3 meters per second. Okay, definitely that proves, without a doubt, that Pluto was experiencing a much greater acceleration because it had a much smaller mass. And that makes sense. Some basic algebra there. So Pluto's quite big, so it wasn't really obviously moving at all. Now, the next experiment that I'm going to do is going to involve changing one more component. So now we're going to maintain the same experimental setup that we've got now with Pluto and Jupiter. But when I change the parameter for Pluto's velocity to start out at 100 kilometers per second, then we're going to be able to test something called gravitational potential. So we'll set the experiment up and I'll show you what I mean in a moment. I'm just like having a look at this actually. This is really quite nice. Jupiter is one of my favorite planets. Saturn is my ultimate favorite. So now let's create a Jupiter. Go add planet and Jupiter. And it puts it right in the middle, not moving. Lovely. Hello, Jupiter. Now let's create Pluto, but I'm going to move Pluto much, much further away so we've got plenty of time to watch what's going on. Now I'm going to use these concentric circles, these rings that we see, as a guide for distance, because if the software works the way real gravitational potential energy works, then if Pluto starts off at 100 kilometers per second, moving towards Jupiter, then it will pass Jupiter, and by the time it's moved the same distance on the other side of Jupiter that it started with, then it should be back to 100 kilometers per second. Because what we can expect, or our hypothesis should be, that Pluto will accelerate towards Jupiter, it will decelerate when it moves away from Jupiter, and if we stop the clock when Pluto's moved an equal distance on the other side of Jupiter, when it's moving away, as it did towards, then Pluto should be back to 100 kilometers per second velocity. So what I'm going to do now is to test that in the software, and I'll just have to make sure everything's aligned properly. Of course, I don't want Pluto to run straight into Jupiter, so I'm going to have to move Jupiter around a little bit. So I'll set Pluto up on its trajectory, and then once that's done, I'll then move them relative to each other so that they miss. I've already given Pluto its 100 kilometers per second. That is so fast, by the way, that is so fast. So there's something that I would really like to see in the software is, you can see me moving these little arrows around. I can move the location of Pluto, but I can't alter its trajectory. I can't actually change its vector or its orientation in terms of which way it's actually going to go. I can change which way it's facing, but its momentum will keep carrying it in the same direction no matter what. I can't do anything because they'd have to apply an external force to that. So they've kind of stuck to the real physics simulation thing there, which is kind of cool, but for practical reasons, and I would love to have been able to get more detail out of this software with the actual fifth experiment, the Voyager test, where I could actually have set up, if I could control that variable, I could have set up the actual trajectory that the Voyager took, both Voyagers actually, and that would have been awesome. So let's just see what's happening here. So Jupiter's moving towards Pluto, or Pluto's moving towards Jupiter, whichever one you want to pick. Ultimately, you know, it's all relative, really. Notice the graph on the left, Pluto's accelerating towards Jupiter. Now, if Jupiter wasn't there, actually, that would be a horizontally flat line, that graph on the left. But because Jupiter is there, we see an acceleration or an increase in velocity and a sudden decrease in velocity as Pluto approaches and passes Jupiter. Now I'm going to stop the clock right as Jupiter matches up with that line, which is the marker that I'm using to show equidistance here. Let's change our perspective and it all goes out of whack, doesn't it? Let's give it a little bit more. There we go. Move it around. Excellent. Alright, so let's open this up, and of course we are still in alpha testing for this software, so a couple of little bugs. This window is having a bit of trouble opening. Come on buddy, you can do it. I believe in you. There we go. can't expand down, no sideways. No, I want you to go down. This is a little bit frustrating. How about... Nope. Oh, you can go up. Okay, how about down? Can you go... Yeah, there we go. All right, if you ask nicely, maybe. So, let's have a look. Okay, so it finished 100 kilometers per second, if you could see just above the arrow. You can see the little digits there. And you can see if you look all the way to the left, you can see that's where it started from. So it started at 100 kilometers per second, and now it's finished at 100 kilometers per second. And in between, we can see this symmetric curve. If you folded left over right, those two lines, the up and the down lines, you can see that they would be symmetrical. They would line up perfectly if you were to fold right down the middle with the crease being in the center of that peak vertically. Those lines would match up. And that's just a, you know, at a glance way to see what might be going on. If someone said to me, here is a body moving through a gravitational field, and they showed me that graph, I'd say, ah, yes, there's, you know, only one body is in motion there. The body that the original craft moved past was stationary relative to it. So let's now have a look. Now, obviously, that is not really what it's like out there in the universe. Things are moving all around, and you never get a perfect set scenario like that. But it's good to be able to do that in this software so that we can see what it looks like when it's just pure, when it's just straight up. So in this experiment number four, we've got Jupiter moving now. Now, it's moving at about its orbital velocity. And in this case, watch what happens to Pluto. All we've changed is that now Jupiter's in motion. Notice that Pluto got pulled towards Jupiter in the direction that it was moving. Now, that's the important part, number one. You could say, well, Jupiter's got gravity. Say, yes, but that's the hand that it used to push. If we have a look at the graph, we can actually see that it's not symmetrical. Pluto now has more kinetic energy than it had before the encounter. And that's really important, because the question you should be asking is, where did that energy come from? We could tell by looking at the experiment before that with Jupiter being stationary, there was no extra energy because it couldn't come from anywhere. Here is the graph from before. So we can see, obviously, you know, there was no extra energy anywhere. But now when we go back and have a look at this next graph, we can see clearly some extra energy came from somewhere. Well, the only thing we changed, the only variable that we changed, was Jupiter's motion. So somehow, the energy that Jupiter had, the kinetic energy of motion of Jupiter, must have been transferred over to Pluto. How did that occur? What was the mechanism for that action? Well, the mechanism was gravity. Gravity acted as the hand that transferred energy from Jupiter to Pluto. And if I went back and did the experiment again and was able to show you Jupiter's energy or velocity, you would see that its kinetic energy or its velocity would actually drop very, very slightly. Because you can't create energy. You can change its form. So now that we understand those basic sorts of principles, you know, you're passing a moving body, you're going to speed up if you happen to pass behind its pathway. So let's now try a simulation. I'm going to fire a rock called Deimos through the solar system, just like the Voyager spacecraft. I'm going to fire it from near Earth, and I'm going to manipulate its trajectory a little bit to try and get it in line. But this software, to the best that I could figure out, doesn't really know where you're going to go. So that line, that extending line way out and above, that line's kind of a rough approximation. What I've actually found is that the actual trajectory is going to be much wider than that. So I can't really calculate with very much accuracy what is going to happen down the line. I'd have to go trial and error, and that, as you could tell, might be a very lengthy process, especially considering that after trying it for about 5 hours myself, I just couldn't quite get two planets lined up properly. There was too much that needed to be in alignment just so that it would work just right. I could get Jupiter and maybe Saturn if I spent like 10 hours preparing it. And that's a long time. Or I could just do what I've done here and readjust the trajectory mid-flight, which is kind of like what they did with the real Voyager spacecraft. They were able to adjust their trajectory and so on. It wasn't just a once-off. So let's have a look. Flinging Deimos out towards Jupiter, and I missed. Yep. Okay, so let's just adjust our trajectory here. Keep adjusting. Looks like it should line up. Now watch that faint line moving off in front of Deimos. Because as we get closer, when I start to line up with Jupiter, you'll see that line, that's the planned trajectory for Deimos. It will start to change as the computer realizes that, oh, you're going to encounter Jupiter's strong gravitational field. And you'll see it start to change rather, well, more dramatically than it currently is. Lots of readjusting here. Let's just keep going. A little bit too far. And that looks, that's pretty close. You need to get within a fairly close margin. Oh, and okay, so Jupiter's well below where we are. Let's adjust this down. There we go. Burning a lot of fuel here. If I was actually doing this in a spacecraft in real space, every time you start moving, you have to burn fuel to stop moving too. So you kind of use twice the fuel. And this would be a very fuel-intensive bit of maneuvering that I'm doing. Which is why calculating and setting up the right trajectory is important. But I couldn't quite manage it in this one. You could imagine that if you were to sum the average of all of these little movements, you would get a nice smooth trajectory. Okay, see that? Did you see? Now the trajectory for Deimos has changed because it's now expecting to encounter Jupiter. That's a good sign. That means I'm on the right track. Although you can see it's pretty straightforward to do. It's not that complicated a task. It's just a little bit repetitive, but interesting nonetheless, because I want to find out if we can get the same graph shape. See, I pulled up this graph, so we're going to be able to see whether or not we actually get the same step up, we'll call it, step up graph, or a symmetrical graph. What is going to be the case? How good am I at creating this situation? And if I micromanage it like this, getting pretty close. There we go. And would you look at that? Fantastic. So that's what they did with the Voyager spacecraft. They sent it from Earth. Wow, look at all of those adjustments. Not very good at setting up the original trajectory, that means. But yeah, they sent the Voyager craft past Jupiter just like that. It gained acceleration there. My system situation or simulation wasn't perfect. And so I only gained a few kilometers per second. They did it with the Voyager craft so that they gained about 13 to 15 kilometers per second. And so they were able to do that for Jupiter, but while they were encountering Jupiter, they were able to line up Saturn as well as a result of that encounter. And then after Saturn, they were able to line up Uranus and Neptune in the same fashion. Really quite remarkable, because when they're mid-flight, it's a little tricky to adjust your trajectory. You get much more bang for your buck if you do it in the beginning. Well, I'll catch you guys next video. Thanks for tuning in. And check out the description for more information and some links to some other cool videos.